some of the best chess games that have ever occurred are dubbed the immortal games. They meant that a certain player tried an idea which was so new and revealing that the whole world had to remember this one game, as though one game became more important than an entire tournament. And one player, his entire life could be expressed in terms of one game.
Nobody has ever played such strong players under clock conditions. He's playing six quite strong players, six serious tournament players, and he's really restricting the amount of time he has, so he's only going to have about 35 minutes per game, which is a huge disadvantage. Plus, he's going to be distracted by playing six games at the same time.
Kasparov is only 24 years old. He was the youngest world champion of all time. He was world champion at age 22. Simply put, the man is a genius.
The chessboard to us is not just 32 pieces or 64 squares. It's the movement of those pieces and the different positions that we see. We can recognize patterns. Whenever I play a game, I make moves, I play positions that nobody has ever played before, and I create ideas that nobody has ever created before, so in that sense, it's very much an art, it's a form of creativity. Psychologically, I'm trying to struggle against myself and also against my opponent, and that also goes on in life, whatever you do, whether it be, sport or business or whatever, you always do. Struggles. So I see chess as sort of a projection, small projection, but a projection of life.
In a given position, I have a plan in this position. Given the plan, we select certain candidate moves that fit in with our plan. And we construct a tree of analysis. If I go here, he can move any of these squares and look at each one by one. So I analyze my candidate moves. At the end, I choose one. But that's really the theory. What a chess player has to fight often is indecisiveness and not trusting himself. Because as you know, chess games are timed, and there really isn't any time for wasted thought.
So, get ready now. Because Stuart Rachel's, I've been told that his main problem is with the clock.
A little stronger.
I remember playing over one of Kasparov's games a year ago, and my trainer, Boris Kogan, showed the position to me, and he said, okay, black to move and win, can you find it? I spent about 15 minutes, I had no idea. So he showed me the first move, and then he showed me White's reply, and he says, black to move and win, can you find it? And I looked at the position a few minutes. I said, no, I have no idea. So then he showed me the whole combination. It was very nice. But the amazing thing was Kasparov played it when he was 13. And, I was 17, and, I thought I was pretty good for a 17-year-old. And when I saw a highly creative combination like this played by someone, so very young, that's something unexplainable.
No, d4. At last.
Mm-hmm. The field that he's taking on is a very strong field. But Kasparov, in individual matches, has beaten up on everybody that he could find. He's beaten up on the top Western European grandmasters. So now just to play somebody individually is not enough of a challenge. It doesn't mean enough to him now. Now he has to take on groups of people.
Okay, Ilya Gurevich, he's approximately 16. I think he's definitely not so strong when he's pulled out a book. And if he can do that attack, he's the person I think you can crush in the shortest space of time.
He doesn't care about you, though. Yeah, he does worry about his opponent.
I think I have a good chance of beating him. I hope my style is contradictory to his, my style of playing. That way, I hope I can somehow confuse him and then make him make a mistake.
Queen of eight, king of eight, rook of one, and then mate.
Oh, that is deep.
It's not so deep.
It is.
That's obvious. It's deep. Marvelous.
Tonight, the best chances seem to lie with Patrick Wolfe, since he's the strongest of all of us six. And he's had more experience than any one of us. He's played in stronger tournaments than any one of us, and he's beaten stronger opponents than I think all of us combined.
This is Patrick with black.
Okay. Strong player.
He's a very strong player.
Strong position.
He's.
I mean, castles, take.
Gotta be relatively equal. White undoubtedly is a sled.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I don't know.
Okay, now I play this one.
Okay, I'll tell you what we have on him. I don't know very much about him. He's very solid, very imaginative.
If I play e6, you don't take, of course, because I play check.
Okay.
But you do this move.
He looks for very deep plans,
mm-hmm.
but he's also willing to change the plan if he sees that it's not working.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He's the most dangerous opponent.
I don't think anybody except Kasparov would attempt to do this kind of thing, because it's nobody likes to lose in chess, especially very good players, and it's very hard to play six games at the same time. So it's almost impossible.
Tonight, it doesn't matter that I win. It doesn't matter if I draw. It doesn't matter if I lose. I hope to engage in one of these brilliant games. If I lose and it's because of a beautiful attack, then wonderful, then I'm part of something. And if I draw, then equally good. And if I win, well, that'd be excellent as well.
I'm just gonna try to make the best moves. Because in chess, if you make the best moves, you won't lose, right?
It's very exciting, of course. The pressure's off you because the worst that can happen is you can lose to a world champion.
Are you thinking about the possibility of being able to beat Garry Kasparov tonight?
I'll try my best. I'm lucky enough to have the white pieces, which is the slight advantage.
Playing the best possible. I like to analyze positions.
Start the spot.
I'm trying to have a date with Mr. Kasparov in 24 minutes. This may break up Perestroika if I start this clock.
Perestroika.
I don't take Russian.
Neither do I.
I pronounce it like Dan Rather, okay?
I thought about it for a long time, and we decided we'd get Toblerone because it's Swiss chocolate, and that we thought would be neutral.
There are chocolates. You can have any of them except for the Toblerone, okay? You can have all the chocolates except for the Toblerone. If there's anything you need, like food or special...
Chocolates?
You can have the chocolates except for the Toblerone, okay?
As the position develops,
he's the world champion, and he's got to defend himself. He's got to defend himself, and I'm going to do everything I can to beat him.
Are you nervous?
Yes.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The world chess champion, Garry Kasparov.
Just before the match begins, we would like to ask everybody's cooperation. In order to play chess at this level, the players are going to be concentrating very intensely, and they cannot have any distractions. So please, no talking.
Chess players can't win games unless they know what their opponent is thinking.
The first crisis came suddenly and very early on.
Rook 12, Kasparov plays queen a5 check again.
Ah, looks like a repetition.
Because when knight comes here, you know, White has his
Kasparov, as black, played a tricky defense against two of his opponents, attempting to neutralize their advantage as white.
Is this a move here, like hitting the bishop and preparing?
He offered them a choice, kind of a psychological dare, either to play on into unknown and difficult territory or repeat the position, thus forcing a draw, ending their games after only 10 moves. It caught everyone by surprise.
White has the choice. In other words, he gave these two Americans the choice of whether or not they want to take a draw with him. But if they do, they're wasting a white, leaving their teammates in effect with black and Kasparov with less worries to think about. And also, it's like a psychological dare. You don't want to take a draw with white. You're supposed to have the advantage.
Fishbein chose to play on and found himself in a totally confusing position. Edelman had to make his own decision.
What do you do when the world chess champion offers you a draw? Do you play like a hero and you try for the win and you get clobbered, or do you take a draw? I decided to take a draw. Is there something wrong with that?
No, I don't want to do this, Rings. You have black, you have white. You have to play. This is my opinion. Sorry. It's not a game. You have white and you play against world champions. It's your only chance.
He was the one who initiated the draw. He made the repetition, which forces white to either take the draw or play some unclear line, which I don't believe gives white an advantage. So I was hoping that he'd play better, but he didn't. He gave me the draw.
You made a bad mistake, yes. Because when I was young, I couldn't miss the chance to play against world champion, even a known position. If you think that this result is much more important for you than the game, sorry, I'm sorry. But I just draw. Ask Abbott. It's unfair.
Garry Kasparov was upset that the Danny Edelman agreed to the draw because he genuinely loves the game. And he wants to play the game. For him, it's more important to play the game than to score a result. For my part, I never at once considered accepting the draw.
The same thing happened on Fishbein's board. Alex Fishbein chose to play to win. And we'll see how smart that decision was. We'll see how well he does in the future. Thank you.
12 or 13, and I suddenly realized that my idea was just wrong. I sat at the board for about 45 or 50 minutes trying to figure out what the hell I could do.
Well, at some point he's gonna have to take this pawn, or he's just gonna be a pawn down.
Yeah.
First impression is that this is good for Kasparov.
When I'm playing a game, and if I'm just worse, I make it my challenge to hold the position. Because if you've had this really horrible position, and if you can convince yourself, well, it wasn't me, it was just this act of God that created this horrible position, and then he put me down and I held it against impossible resistance, you know? It's a good feeling, and that's the kind of attitude that you have to get yourself into for holding a bad position. I found my best chance was to attack on the king's side to distract him from what was going on in the center of the board.
Wolf played surprise move queen h6, threatening me.
Oh, well, I certainly didn't see that.
Kasparov responded by h4.
So Kasparov avoided that, he simply played h4, maintaining the pressure on this guy.
He sat at the board for about 10 minutes, found a very interesting, very complicated defense, which he undoubtedly calculated about 5 or 6 moves deep.
But the definite impression is that Kasparov will easily find a defense to this stuff. Not that the attack is that weak, but that White is going to find a way. Surely Kasparov will find a way.
Let's look for a way. Knight d5, bishop c5.
Okay, you want to look for a way.
Not only was it a complete turnaround, but at the same time, it was a completely unbelievable sequence of moves. It was the logical idea in the position, which I developed as best that I could, but the resulting positions were just amazing.
At this point, it had become very serious. Kasparov realized that he might actually have to go down in the Wolf game. He wanted to block it out of his mind for a while and move on to the other games. He had some very nice positions on the other boards, but they were going to take some work. Stewart had a completely winning position at this point because Kasparov was letting his pawns just fall off the board without getting anything for it. He was looking for some vague attacking chances, but in terms of the objective analysis of the game, Stewart was winning.
When I play, I'm almost perpetually nervous. And you sort of have to be nervous enough so that you can concentrate, but not so nervous that it destroys your concentration. It's a fine line. And when I'm playing a game and it's going well, I don't tell myself it's going well until it's over, because you can't relax, because then you won't win.
At this point, he must have been getting upset with himself at letting things come to this stage.
One of Garry's problems is that there are very few opponents that can stand up to him. And he has demonstrated this, easily beat them in much less time than he has to stay at the board in a one-to-one game. Garry was taking a risk in this event here. You're not supposed to be able to do this kind of thing. That anyone dares to challenge a team that is so strong all by himself. I don't think it's ever been done at this level before.
I'm used to the silent tension. I'm used to the idea of fighting somebody silently, symbolically across the chessboard. I'm used to the idea of exchanging these ideas and searching for the truth in a position. It's what I do. And when a chess game is going really well, it's a good feeling. It makes you have a wonderful feeling of pride, as well as kind of a bit of a sadistic feeling of, I'm really gonna get this guy.
So it's really a very, very beautiful victory for Wolf. Kasparov will lose a point over there. He'll pick up 3 points. So far, it looks like on Gurevich, Fishbein, and Rao. And this is totally up in the air. I mean, if Rachel manages to score in this game, then the Americans have done very well here.
Now Stuart Rachels had been thinking. This is part of Kasparov's plan. He knew that Rachels was a time trouble addict, so Kasparov simply moved his whole army forward into Rachels' position. The threats weren't really so tangible, but Garry gave Rachels no time to think. Stuart found himself with only 11 minutes for 24 moves. You have to make 50 moves in 2.5 hours. His first 26, he had used almost his whole time. Given that, it was really quite a tough situation for Rachels, even though he was winning on the board. Gurevich's position was quite lost at this point. It was just a question of time, or really how long Ilya wanted to provide a distraction for his teammate. That was the big break for Garry in this match, that he managed to turn a position which had totally deteriorated into a win for himself. It almost made up for the fact that Kasparov had lost to Wolf. That left Kasparov with 2 games against Rao and Fishbein, and Kasparov seemed to have the advantage in the endgame against both. After a long and difficult struggle, Rao finally resigned. Garry had the advantage in his endgame with Fishbein, and now only needed to convert it into a win.
There are times during a game where I'm about to lose and just, I'm dead. You know, my opponent has crushed me, the game is over. And I try not to have those emotions. I try to always feel that I have a chance to win for as long as I can. I try to fight. In many of my games, I've been able to hold a draw in positions where it seems everybody thought I was losing. After the opening, I didn't feel very good about my position. I was right. At one point in the game, I felt that I had a better position. I'm probably not right there. I played very hard. I had a bad position, but I played very hard until the end, and I fought till I had no chances. You know, and whatever chances I had, I made the most of them. So I probably couldn't have played the ending much better than I did.
Thank you.
Kasparov made a mistake at the end of the game, which allowed me the chance to draw the game. Had he played the correct continuation, I believe he would win the game, but he didn't. Kasparov himself said once, a game against the world champion is like a test. It's like a test of your ability.
Could you play D4?
Oh, again?
Yes.
Okay.
You can play it?
I'm not sure, because after D4, then you have F3, this move. Sorry?
A tragic story.
Yes. Oh, it's tragic for one side.
Well, what happens on the side?
It used to be that you could be a reasonably well-rounded person and very, very, very gifted in chess and be world champion.
What's happening?
Now, you have to have an entire system behind you, an entire support structure to create the optimal conditions possible, and you have to have a certain fanatical devotion to the game. Kasparov has that.
All right, can we go like slower so I can follow and try to find an idea?
And even if the United States were to produce another chess player who had that kind of fanatical devotion, it's questionable whether without the support structure the Soviet Union has, that person could be world champion. So anyway, in the near future, I don't see an American world champion. Much as I would like to see one, I don't see one.
For Kasparov, becoming a chess professional was a very natural choice when he was very young. The people around him recognized his great talent, and chess is state-sponsored and encouraged. So for Kasparov, who had all the best trainers, it's very natural that he's going to become a chess professional. He got better and better. You know, suddenly he was one of the top five players in the world. But in the United States, you really have to love the game, because there's not only the problems with travel and with work, but it's just problems with money. I mean, you're just going to be poor unless you become the very best.
I was in trouble, big trouble. I was liking this game. It was good compensation for another one.
With most chess players, there's a limit to the skill that they can reach. You know, chess is such a difficult game that it's impossible to master it completely. I think all of the players in the Simul are talented enough to become grandmasters, and I feel that, I would really, that's certainly one of my goals now. And I think, like everybody else in the Simul, I sort of feel that it'd be nice to become the best in the world, too.